Hi, this is Mick Murphy of The System, and you're listening to LOTL Radio, the rebirth of the quiet storm. And just like Goldilocks said in the fable of the three bears, this one's just right. So stay tuned with number one teddy bear right here on LOTL Radio.
Well, the creative process of this single and the upcoming songs is just really taking the time for people to get to know me. As an artist in television and film and theater, you get to show so many other people's lives from your perspective. You know, everybody got a chance to fall in love with, hate, root for, want to bash Janine, you know, because you really felt like you were a part of her life. The same with Monica on the Ricky Smiley show. But when it came to Demetria, you know, nobody really knew who she was because I've been so many people. So especially with tracks like Work With Me, Work With Me, ladies, we tend to always focus on what he did. We talk about how he did us crazy, but we don't talk about the baggage that we kind of bring in from leftover relationships. So, you know, it's saying I'm flawed. It's saying, yeah, I messed up, but you make me feel sexy. You make me feel beautiful. And if you just give me a little bit of time to heal myself, I got you. You know, so these are the types of things, these are real life scenarios that I've been in and that I understand and I know that I'm not alone in. So the creative process in making songs like Work With Me or even Still Believe in Love, it's honest. I'm trying to be as honest about who I am as possible.
You know, I'm glad you brought that up, and I'm going to take it a step further. I find it interesting for me from a male perspective. I think all of us have a certain amount of baggage. Some have a little bit more overnight kids than others, but, you know, that's a part of life. That's a part Absolutely. Of life. Absolutely. Speaking from a woman's perspective, we see a lot of women from every ethnic background go through that, where they've gone through previous relationships, things didn't work out, and they have a tendency of what didn't work out, they bring it into their next relationship as far as major trust issues. For you, you have put a lot of your life out there for everyone to see. How important is it for you to remain true to that and also to give more input as far as to give, I guess, a different dimension on who Demetria McKinney really is and what she represents, not just as an artist, but as a woman?
As a woman, I want to represent, to the best of my ability, triumph. There are going to be trials. There's going to be tribulations, Jesus. There's going to be ups, downs. There's going to be baggage. But especially when it comes to being a woman, you know, I'm very independent, but I also know that I desire and can appreciate the love of a good, strong man right next to me. I also know that just like, you know, for lack of a better analogy, if I know I wore that lingerie with that dude, I'm not going to wear that same lingerie with this dude. I can't bring old habits, old whatever, into a brand new relationship. It's just not going to be the same. It's not going to get a chance to grow or flourish. And as far as just emoting everything that we are, being a woman is a beautiful thing. It's hard, but it can be so beautiful. And no matter what you face relationship-wise, with your kids, I'm a single mom, with work, with everything, you know, you can do what you want to do. You can be who you want to be. You can be sexy without being raunchy. You can be a Christian without having to be just a nun. I mean, there are just so many dimensions to being a woman, and I want to show that each dimension that we go through, we can be triumphant in them.
You know, I find it very ironic that you said something like that. I had the pleasure of having Selena Johnson on the show last night, and she's very spiritual. But at the same time, when I spoke with her, it's almost like a battle because she has such a strong spirituality base, but she has to always catch herself as far as what kind of music or what things she is saying in her music as far as not going overboard, as far as being, we go from being provocative to being a little bit more naughty. And for you, how are you able to, you know, because you know yourself, being in this industry, there's certain things that record labels or quote-unquote executives expect from a female artist, and a lot of it is not predicated on the pure essence of music. It's predicated on a look and appearance. How have you remained truthful to yourself to make sure you say, you know what, those are just certain boundaries I'm not crossing. I want it to be all predicated on my music.
I think, again, like with the acting and the music, it's a balancing act. You know, I think that there is something to be said for people appreciating the beauty that is a woman without trying to extort it. And I've chosen to go independently because I want the creative control. I want to be able to say the things that I want to be able to say with the intention I have them in. You know, I may say, you know, what the H-E-double-L, but it's not to cuss anybody out. It's just the feeling. It's the intention. It could be a laugh following. It could be a whatever. But if I have a label who wants to have me in a half top and some booty shorts every single day of my life, that might not be the type of person I want to represent. So I've made it a point to be independent. I've made it a point to really look at myself with each project. If I don't like what the song is saying, and I appreciate writers, I love working with new writers and new people, but if they're not on the same vibe as me, I've learned how to say no. I know how to be polite. I know how to be distinct. But at the end of it, if this is my project, I really have to make sure it's my project.
Absolutely. I remember one of the key essential things we talked about, and it has always left an indelible imprint in my mind. We were discussing marketing, how essentially important marketing is, because at the end of the day, that's where you're able to develop and market your brand, not just here in the States, but internationally. Can you explain to the listeners out there how important it is that you have the right kind of marketing and you're able to market your brand in so many different genres and areas as far as the entertainment industry?
The wild thing about the entertainment industry is whether you want to or not, you are a marketed individual. You are a role model. You are a disgrace. You are whatever. But you are going to be marketed as something. You know, the same way that Celine said, you know, it's a constant battle. You know, as an artist and as an actress, I play some characters people don't like. In the Up Network TV movie called In the Meantime, I played a true female dog. I was mean. I was evil. I didn't like me when we were sitting there in the premiere. But you know, that's not who I am. But if you don't really get a chance to know me and you look at the body of work that I do, I am marketed as the angry black woman or the woman who's just going to cause dissension. So as far as marketing myself, I make it a point to exercise all that I am. And as long as I do that, the marketing is going to fall in the place that it's in. And it doesn't help to be affiliated with like-minded people. You know, working alongside Mr. Tyler Perry and Cassie Davis and LeVan and Alan Payne and Lance Gross, these are all people who have an upstanding reputation. The same now with the Ricky Smiley show. You know, birds of a feather flock together. That's not anything different with marketing. And as this show grows and as this music grows, then the marketing continues to grow, especially if you have a machine like, you know, the TV ones or the you know, HBOs and all of that type of stuff behind you. Now, making sure that you concentrate on your brand is the top priority. Nobody is going to take care of you like you, despite the best intentions. So if I don't wake up in the morning and I don't do my tweeting, and social media has become so important in marketing, if I'm not about my business every day, I shouldn't expect anybody else to be. And sometimes with the machines in place, you know, we can get really lackadaisical and really comfortable and really, you know, stand stillish or stagnant. And that's the worst thing that you can do. Recognize that you are always, always, always going to be marketed, but be in control of what that market is.
Absolutely. I mean, the incredible thing for me, because I come from a different era of music, and we didn't have the social media. And I see a lot of artists during that era, as far as the 60s, 70s, and even the 80s, are having a very difficult time adapting to today's social media, as far as being able to get out there and self-market their own product. Because we just have a handful of record labels, and these handful of record labels, to me, are positioned to focus on glitz and glamour instead of the music, as far as putting the music forefront. Is no more, you know, A&R people that actually were artists that knew how to market another artist. For you as a singer, and I strictly want to say as a singer, how important is it to you that you are able to market your music internationally? Because it seems to me now the UK and internationally overall, and especially Japan. It's incredible how they have just engulfed R&B music. They love it. Do you want to get your music in that kind of direction as far as international, the international market?
Absolutely. I think that good music is a universal language. I don't care if it's Turkey, Japan, China, the UK. It doesn't matter where it is. People understand good music, and that's why the artists of the earlier years won the way that they did. It didn't matter that Whitney Houston was singing in English. People over in Japan loved that Ding Dang song.
Oh, yeah.
It was something you felt. It was something you knew. It was something you connected to. And getting my music over into the other genres and into the other countries is something I definitely am looking forward to doing. And I wanted to say something else about that social media thing. You know, you said that a lot of the previous artists were having a hard time connecting to the social media thing, which, of course, can get you into those other markets like the UK and everything. But
right.
The biggest thing for me is, you know, we are now in a time where people want to really know who you are, and social media has opened up that gate. You didn't have to do that before. You know, it was enough to know about the music, but now they want to know about your life. They want to know who you are. They want to know if you live what you sing. They want to know if you walk the talk. So the scary part of social media is that they're going to know you. You know,
right.
people were able to hide behind whatever for a really long time, and it's not even necessarily a hiding versus keeping some sort of anonymity about themselves. Not so much anymore. We live in a world of reality stars turning into musicians. We live in a world of you know, YouTube. YouTube now has a music award coming up, I believe, that they
yes. Yes, they do.
Yes,
they do.
But that's just a testament. And those are the people who are getting the national exposure and the worldwide exposure. And, you know, so it's all hand in hand.
I've always disliked the term, quote unquote, fans. It's a detachment from the artists. I've always looked at those as supporters. You have an overabundance, and that's being kind when I say that. You have an overabundance of supporters, a lot of highly intelligent young ladies who just adore you, everything you do. I mean, my program director came to me, you know what, Demetria was having a cup of tea. They're tweeting about it. I said, wow, we are definitely, we're definitely in a different time. But I do agree with you is that now with the social media, there's no more, like you say, the man behind the curtain anymore. Don't pay attention to the man behind the curtain, the Wizard of Oz mentality.
Right.
Everything that you do is under scrutiny. From the time you wake up in the morning, from the time you leave the house, you have the paparazzi following everything you do. Where does it leave time for private times? For a person, for an artist like yourself, we say, hey, look, I understand. I have a lot of people out there who love me, but I still want to keep a certain part of my life. I want to keep it private. How are you able to balance that?
Oh, man, the beautiful thing about, you know, my family, that's what I call them.
Yes,
Aisha, Faith Brown, Shelby, Sydney, all of these people, Andrea Lachey, all of these people who get up every day and they fight the Demetria cause, they are entitled to a certain percentage of who I am because of the fact that they make me who I am. And that's one of the things that the celebrities, the quote-unquote celebrities of nowadays have to be prepared for. If you want in this light, you have to be ready for everything that comes with it. There are times that I'm out with my son and I'm kicking it, and we're acting silly, and somebody's going to take a picture, and they're going to repost it, and they're going to put a caption that wasn't exactly what was going on, so I have to be careful and cognizant, and I have to teach him as well. So when we're at home, we let loose. When we're out, I have to be, I have to be on point. Now,
right. There
are, like I said, there is so much power in no, and it's not that you have to be a but, it's not that you have to be a B, but you have to set the boundaries that you want people to respect. Like, I'm very happy in my relationship. I'm very, very content in that. But I don't broadcast who I'm with because just following the notes of somebody who can never just let go, Beyonce and Jay-Z kept that thing to a minimum of exposure until they were ready, and they set the standard for what people were going to know about their relationship. And that's why it's had the longevity and success and happiness that it's had. So, you know, being a celebrity or being on television and all of that stuff has definitely made me a target for being an open book. But I still have the editorial right. I still have the opportunity to say, okay, we're not going to necessarily write that in the book quite yet. They're not ready for all of that, or that's mine. That's my little nugget. So I'm very, very cautious about what I put out. I'm very cognizant of the questions that are asked of me, and I've learned the art of no.
And it is definitely an art form to say no, because it really is.
Right. It's like, you know, who are you dating? No.
Right.
You know, I don't mean any disrespect. I don't mean anything. But we all have those moments that we have to have to ourselves. So.
You know, I can totally understand and definitely respect that. And speaking of respect, we are definitely honored to have the very lovely and extremely talented Demetria McKinney here on the show, of course, from Tyler Perry's House of Pain and also new music. And that's what we need to get into. First and foremost, I love the video. Still believe in love. I love that video. The cinematography, you looked gorgeous, but that's nothing new. You always look gorgeous. I said to myself, how did Musiq Soulchild become so lucky enough to get in the video with you? But that's another time. What was it like doing the video with him, and who came up with the concept of the video?
Okay, that video was a dream. A dream. I have wanted to do a music video, and despite being on television, despite doing film and theater, doing your own music video for something that you're passionate about is a whole nother feeling. And then having it include Musiq Soulchild, whose music and whose talent and whose knowledge I have looked up to for so long, was just unreal. He's so cool. He's so down to earth. I tell people all the time, he's the best brand of idiot you will ever meet. For somebody to have that much experience, that many accolades, and to still be willing to share and listen and learn. In writing Still Believe in Love, you know, I came up with the concept that I still want to believe in love. Yeah, this happened. But, you know, I'm going to try again. It's scary, but I'm going to do it. And he produced the track. So the next day we came back in the studio, he was like, hey, would you mind if I get on there with you? Beep, yeah. Who I'm going to say? Am I really going to say no to that? You know, so doing the video was wonderful. The concept was come up with by that video was directed by Roger Bob of Bobcat Films, and he's a visionary. He was the executive vice president of Tyler Perry Studios for a really long time, but even more so than that, he's also had his hand in the Def Jam videos and everything. Like, he has an extensive history, and I trust his eye. So he came up with the idea and concept for the video, and we ran with it, and I'm very happy with how it turned out.
Well, you did a magnificent job. So without further ado, let's get into it. The hit single, of course, from the lovely Demetria McKinney. And, of course, a little help from Musiq Soulchild. Still Believe in Love here in the Comfort Zone. LOTL Radio.
You don't know which one's going to pop off.
I have been helping you.
First of all, I can't create when I got somebody breathing down my neck all the time.
I'm breathing down your neck. I'm trying to spend time with you.
Back when I was young, girls running my heart, but I was having fun. I was only ready to go with the ones ready to go. Bang, bang, and I was out the door. So I never thought I would ever fall in love. But even more, I never thought I'd end up getting hurt. First time I get my heart, I get it broken with her. But I still believe in love. Oh, now I feel like I wanna die.
McKinney, and of course, Musiq Soulchild with the hit single, Still Believe in Love, here on LOTL Radio. Out of all the things that I have ever seen you do, and it's just from my perspective, that is the freest that I've ever seen you be on the video. I mean, you just,
absolutely,
you let loose, because to me, every relationship has gone through that process, because when you have a man that's work, 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 work. And all that woman wants is just his time. She wants time. She wants time and emphasis put on the relationship. For you, being in a relationship, being a mother, my goodness, and I can speak as being a parent, I know how this industry can just take so much of your time. How have you been able to maintain and keep an even balance, where you're able to kind of spread yourself around, where you're able to give emphasis and importance on both careers as far as being an artist, an actress, but also most importantly, being a mother?
Well, my son and I have really good communication. And even when I was doing the tours with Mr. Perry, you know, he would have moments where he would call and he'd say, okay, it's been long enough. I really need to see you. And we would make it happen. You know, he understands what I do. I'm very, very communicative about what each role I'm doing is going to require of me, even down to doing Church Girl, in which I played a stripper. I talk to him. You know, I never want him to hear what I'm doing from anybody but me. So then he's prepared. And I listen to him, and he listens to me. So, you know, and in him doing what he needs to do, it takes a lot of the pressure off of me and what I have to do. He's very mature. He's very understanding. He gets it. And he allows me the latitude to do what I need to do while still letting me know what he needs. And it's a give and take.
We always search for that unconditional love, and I think there's no greater unconditional love that we get from our child or we get from our children. What is it like when you go through that day, and we all have those days, where things are not kind of going good, but then when you go home and you know you have someone, that they're not looking at you as an actress or a singer, but just as mom, and they give you that hug. What is that feeling like?
It is awesome, and sometimes it sucks. because he doesn't see me as Janine or as a celebrity, you know, he's not necessarily as inclined to be as awestruck when I walk through the door. Sometimes it's,
right,
oh man, he's here, you know. I didn't clean my room yet. I didn't do my homework yet, you know. So it's kind of a double-edged sword, but it's wonderful to know
that at the end of it, whether what I'm doing is flopping or rising, you know, I have somebody in my corner.
Wow. You know what? It brings a real human element to it, because it's like, here I am, I'm, you know, I'm on a house of pain, I'm doing this, I'm doing movies, doing music, but when I come home, I'm not looked at as Demetria.
I can't get you to brush your teeth. Brush one tooth, please. Yes, it's great.
It is definitely a beautiful, definitely a beautiful thing. My goodness. We're being honored this evening by the one and only Demetria McKinney. And be sure, family, to purchase both singles, actually all three singles, Work With Me, of course, Still Believe, and also Takeaway, all available on iTunes and also Amazon.com. And make sure that you stop by Demetria's official website. That's at DemetriaMcKinney.com, and be sure to check on our itinerary. And speaking of itinerary, what is up next for you? When are we going to have an opportunity to see you perform live?
Well, I have actually been starting my performances this past summer. V103 does for Sisters Only, and I was blessed and fortunate enough to be the only independent artist up on the same stage as the Sierras, as the Tamar Braxtons, as the, all of these label artists. I was the only independent one, so they believe in me, and they've been working really hard at pushing my stuff as well. So I'm in the process of performing, getting ready to do another video for Work With Me. Still Believe in Love is actually being played on Centric TV's video station right now. Deranged. How about that segue? Deranged is a place that I am doing opposite of Robin Givens, Malik Yoba. I mean, some incredible people in this cast. And it is going on tour in November so that I can still do some of the theatrical stuff I love to do. There's a movie called Let the Church Say Amen, which is Regina King's directorial debut that's coming out by the end of the year. The Ricky Smiley Show finale was tonight. It was wonderful. We've truly, truly enjoyed all the support everybody has given us, and hopefully that will be another renewed season. And I've got a couple of movie scripts on the table. So it's still popping, it's still going, and I will definitely keep everybody abreast.
All right. I've always wanted to ask, and I didn't get an opportunity last time. For you, what do you find more challenging, doing stage plays or doing as far as television shows?
I think stage plays are harder. With television shows, you get do-overs. You
right.
have time to, you know, fix whatever didn't quite go right. You know, somebody can step in with makeup, but you're on stage, you got that booger in your nose, it's staying, boo, unless you have a really good partner. You slip and fall, you have to figure out how to make that work. You crack, there's no do-over. So the thrill of the instant gratification versus the opportunity to try and fix an error is always, always going to be more difficult to me than television.
Now, just from my humble opinion, I may be wrong, won't be the first time, definitely will not be the last. To me, I've always seen you shine when you've done stage work. I mean, to me, you're at home when you do stage plays. It's a level of comfort. It's almost like the feeling like, you know, Demetria's at home. She's sitting in her living room on the couch. It's that level of comfort that you have when you're doing stage plays instead of television. It seems to me you have a lot more freedom to stretch out. Like you said, you can't do any do-overs. You're right there, so improvisation really kicks in. If you do make a mistake, you have to do that. Can you give us a description? What is it like? What kind of feeling do you get when you're able to do stage plays? The camaraderie that you get with the rest of the cast.
The camaraderie is wonderful. The connection and the chemistry is great. But when I tell you, I get up there and I am nervous every single time. And it doesn't matter if I've done the play for a week or a year. The opportunity for growth and the desire to do well each night is a pressure that I gladly put on myself every day. So getting up on stage, you know, you're right. It feels a lot more comfortable, but it's because I'm not. It's because I'm always looking for new ways to do something to heighten the experience of what I'm giving. I'm always looking for some way to help draw the person I'm acting opposite of into the scene more so that we can give the audience more. And then the audience gives just as much as we do. You know, when they're into it, when they're laughing, they're crying, even when you got that heckler that's like, dude, he ain't right. You know, it feeds us. It's wonderful. And it is the most gratifying part of entertainment for me. So, yes, thank you so much for for saying that I do well on stage. I love it. And when you have the Denzel Washingtons going up and doing Fences on Broadway, when he doesn't have to, there's something to be said for that. There is a training ground that you will not get anywhere but on stage. And if the veterans realize it and they go back to the basics of it, I will always, always, always be a part of it, even aside from the love for it.
Absolutely. Every actor that I've heard as far as giving, you know, various interviews, they've always said the reason why they get so much gratification as far as doing stage plays, because it's that personal interaction that they have an opportunity with the people. You know, you're sitting
yep.
there and you have that personal. It's different when you're on a movie set and you're rehearsing 12, 13, 14 hours a day to do maybe one or two scenes. But when you
right.
get out on stage and you have that personal interaction, as you said, you can have a heckler say, you know what, you're not right, get her. You know, it's something that comes over you. It's like, wow.
Yeah.
It's
I'm
completely
making a difference.
Yeah, it's completely
yeah,
different.
Yeah, you get to see your work. Absolutely. You see your work working. You see what's working, what's not, what you need to change the next day. You know, by the time it's put on tape and it's in that movie theater, if nobody fixed it, nobody's going to fix it. That's your body of work, you know? So, yeah, absolutely. The audience, like I said, they are the last cast member in any production that you do on stage.
We have a caller on hold. Let's get to it. Going to area code 716. You're on the line with Demetria McKinney and, of course, the teddy bear. Caller, what is your name and what is your question? Go right ahead.
Hi, this is Iesha Marie, and I'm calling to say hey to Didi. Iesha! Hey, family. Hey. I don't have a question. I just wanted to tell her how proud I am of her and all of her accomplishments. I don't know, why am I always not able to speak to you? Didn't we meet?
That's great. I so support you give, Iesha. I can't thank you enough.
Iesha, you were too much. You were too much.
They did not play, and I'm so thankful.
You were too much. You know
oh,
what?
Goodness.
To all the many listeners out there, if you're not familiar with Iesha, I had Iesha on the show over a year ago when Demetria
was on.
Oh, yes, my love. I remember you.
I didn't think you would remember me.
Sweetheart, I remember you. And you talking about someone that's diligent. I mean, when I say diligent, when it comes to Demetria McKinney, it is incredible. I'm going to tell you something. If I had an extra 10 people in my camp that are as diligent as you, my goodness, I would be on Cyrus. Hit. I'm getting on my people now, telling you, hey, you
yes.
make things happen. getting on them now. But I want to thank you for calling. Also, you know what, while we have you on, I want you to give out all the pertinent information for Demetria. Can you do that for me?
All the what?
All the pertinent information as far as a website, Twitter page, Facebook. You go right ahead. The form
you give up her information or the fan
yeah.
page?
The fan page.
Give all mine. Let's see if you know it. I know she does. Go on and give us how to get in touch with me.
Okay. Twitter page, Demi McKinney, D-E-M-I, as in Demi McKinney, and Instagram, Demetria, number 4 real. Website, DemetriaMcKinney.com. Facebook, officially Demetria McKinney, not none of the fake ones. Did I get all of them?
You got all of them.
Wow.
Oh, I'm done. Oh, I thought there were more. So,
wow.
Y'all want
wow,
to do fan page now or just stop?
You did wonderful. Well, can you give us the honor of introducing Demetria's new hit single?
Of course.
Please go right ahead.
You about to play it? Okay.
Yes.
Here's Demetria McKinney, new hit single, Work With Me.
You hear it here first in the comfort zone, LOTL Radio. With me, the new hit single, of course, from the one and only Demetria McKinney, available on iTunes. But I've always said, if you're feeling even more adventurous, you can always head over to Amazon.com. Every opportunity that I've had a chance to have you on the show, you have always brung me some cheesecake, a hit single after hit single after hit single. Now, I must ask, when can I expect, when can the many listeners out there expect a full course meal? We want an album, an entire CD, even if it's an EP. When can we expect that?
We are trying to have the EP out to you all by the end of the year. And we are currently also working at the same time on the LP. So we coming for y'all.
Oh, that's a beautiful thing. And remember, family, be sure to stop by the pertinent information and get all the pertinent information, all the various websites, as Iesha eloquently informed us. Yes, Lord, it's a beautiful thing. My queen, it is always a wonderful pleasure to have you on the show. I can tell that your writing is improving with each endeavor, and I can't wait to see what this EP is going to be like when the next single is ready. All you have to do is send it over here to the Teddy Bear, and we will debut it here first. That I do promise.
Thank you so much for your continued support, Teddy Bear. Thank you so, so much.
Oh, it's always a pleasure. The one and only Demetria McKinney, you have a blessed evening, my love, okay?
You too.
All right. It's a beautiful thing. Lord have mercy. Remember, family, be sure to catch up with Demetria. That's at Demetria McKinney. That's the official website, DemetriaMcKinney.com. You can also catch up with her on Facebook. That's on Facebook.com/Demetria McKinney. And also on Twitter. That's at Twitter.com/Demetria McKinney. And I just want to make sure, let me get Iesha back here on the line, because I want to make sure we're giving the correct information. Iesha?
Yes.
Yes, my. I just want to double check, my queen. I want to make sure we're giving all the correct and pertinent information, so we make sure all the many listeners are getting to the correct website. So if you would do us the honor, can you give us that information one more time?
Yes, Demetria McKinney Twitter page is Demi McKinney, Instagram Demetria number 4 real, Facebook officially Demetria McKinney, and website DemetriaMcKinney.com.
You know, I got to come get you so I can get you to work for this team. You are doing a fantastic job. All right.
Thank you.
My pleasure, my queen. We got some more music on the way, some new music from Selena Johnson, Troop. We got it all just hanging there with the Teddy Bear here in the comfort zone, LOTL Radio.